thank you. Thanks a lot to everyone for coming. It's a very beautiful day. I wouldn't have came here to listen to myself. I would have just sat outside and have lunch. Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for everyone who put the event together. Thanks, John, for driving me all the way from today. I moved to the U.S. in 2005. I was born in Baghdad. I spent most of my life living between Iraq and Jordan and Saudi Arabia. But I've been living in the U.S. since 2005. And most of my work now is political and humanitarian work. I stopped working as an architect, unfortunately. And I always feel bitter about it because I didn't really have the privilege to decide to change my career. It's not like I woke up one morning and decided to save the world and start working on political issues. You know, bombs fell on my neighborhood and I stopped being capable of doing architectural work. So I always admire people who are actually interested in peace and justice issues without having bombs falling in their neighborhoods. I mean, I wasn't really interested that much in it. It's really harder to get involved in issues that has to do with morality and struggles when someone is, you know, not struggling himself or with his family. Now, the U.S. involvement in Iraq started a long time ago. Now, there's a public misconception that the war started in 2003. Well, that's the occupation. The occupation started in 2003. But the war started before. It started in 1990 and 1991. It's been a while. And the U.S. foreign policy during this period, from 1991 until now, hasn't shifted a lot. It's been more or less the same policy. So it's a policy based on interfering in Iraq and dominating the region politically and militarily, maybe even socially and religiously. This policy of domination has been going on for almost two decades. And people like myself who grew up in Baghdad realize that whether it's the first Bush or Clinton or the second Bush, the same bombs continue to fall on our neighborhoods and the same sanctions continue to destroy Iraq and kill Iraqis. There aren't many differences in U.S. foreign policy when it comes to the two parties in Washington, D.C. They are very similar. Now, while the policies and the practices have not shifted a lot, the same militarized foreign policies have been implemented for 18 years. The excuses given to justify them has shifted a lot. There are always new excuses. There are always new myths given to justify the U.S. foreign policy. And these excuses move on. You know, whenever a myth is debunked, the mainstream politicians and mainstream media moves on to the next one. In the early 90s, the main excuses given to justify the intervention in Iraq were more about protecting Iraq from, or protecting Iraq's neighbors from Iraq. And then it shifted to protecting Iraqis from their government. And then after that, it became about protecting Iraqis from other Iraqis. Sometimes Sunnis from Shiites, sometimes Shiites from Sunnis, sometimes Muslims from Christians, sometimes Kurds from Kurds. It keeps on moving. And it kept on shifting and shifting. In fact, one of the official reasons given to justify the U.S. foreign policy in Iraq in the late 90s, just to show you how ridiculous the excuses can be, one of the official reasons was that the U.S. must continue doing whatever it's doing to save the birds in the marshes. They said there are endangered bird species in the marshes in the south of Iraq that must be rescued. tell you the truth, I wish I was an endangered bird species at that time. Maybe that would have helped the Iraqis and stopped the sanctions, you know. Around the 2000, when the invasion was, when the preparations for the invasion was happening, all of us know that the two major excuses were weapons of mass destruction. They said Iraq has these unprecedented weapons of mass destruction that can destroy the universe in 30 minutes. And of course, all Iraqis knew that there were no weapons, because I personally saw the United Nations inspection teams going around my neighborhood and my school more than one time. Iraqis know that every square inch in Iraq was searched. In fact, at one moment, they even searched the bedrooms of the president of Saddam Hussein and his bathrooms. This was like a big standoff, you know. They said, unless you open the presidential palaces, we'll bomb Iraq. So they had to open the presidential bedrooms for inspection, because maybe he has a nuclear weapon under his bed or something, you know. Now, the other reason was given is Iraq's links to Al-Qaeda. And now all of us know that Iraq was never linked to Al-Qaeda, was never linked to 9/11. Iraq was actually one of the first governments to condemn 9/11 and to offer help for the US government. And the Iraqis, as peoples, were among many other populations around the world who stood with the American people with compassion on 9/11. Now, after that shifted, of course, after the invasion and after the fall of Baghdad, it shifted to bringing democracy and human rights. And now, where we stand now, the two major excuses given to justify the same old policies. The two excuses given to say we have to stay in Iraq, we can't finish the occupation, we have to continue there. These two excuses come from the two major parties in DC. Republicans usually say that a US occupation is important for our security. They say if we withdrew from Iraq, terrorists will take over, and then they might attack the U.S. in a new 9/11, and therefore we have to continue the same old policy. Now, Democrats, reaching out to the other constituency, the less conservative, the more progressive constituency, they tell them, we have to stay in Iraq, we can't end the occupation. But not because we are imperialists who want to occupy Iraq or anything. We have to be there because we love them. The Democratic Party's theory of intervention is that if we withdrew the troops from Iraq, the sky will fall and the Sunnis and Shiites will kill each other in the streets and the genocide will happen. And therefore, for humanitarian reasons, we have to keep the troops in Iraq a little bit longer until it's stabilized. Now, to tell you the truth, these two excuses don't sell well in Iraq, and we never hear from the Iraqi public or their elected officials. We never hear what they say. Are they afraid of Al-Qaeda taking over? Are they afraid of a genocide and a civil war or not?